Welcome to another edition of the RGDS podcast with me as your host, Matt Aguilera, not Matt Lambourne. I know we do sound similar sometimes. We grew up about less than a mile away from each other, so that's a whole story for another day. And with us today, we've got a very special, esteemed guest and now published author at Amazon.com. That would be Paul Driscoll, otherwise known as the Drisk. I've never called him Paul in his life, which I don't actually know if he likes or doesn't like. So
happy to be called whatever, really. But brilliant. It's great to sort of be on here. It's nice to...
Well, you enjoy it, don't you? You love writing about games. You're always playing retro games. You've got an encyclopedic knowledge, and you've paid that off by actually going out there and writing about the history of games before 1977.
Yeah, exactly. I thought try and do a book series. If you just search Paul Driscoll on Amazon, you should find the book. It's basically trying to tell the story in hopefully quite a readable format, quite entertaining format, just going through the entire history.
Brilliant. But back then, of course, there was no weird CD add-ons that may have caused the fall of one of the best game publishers and game hardware specialists of the time. Yeah. And today, of course, we're going to be talking about the SEGA Mega CD. And the reason we're going to be talking about this is because out of nowhere, we just started talking about it in our Facebook chat. We're talking about the games that we liked and people who were fond of certain systems. And I put it out there that I love the Mega CD, but in some ways I pity it along with love it as well. But I have to say that when I had it, it felt like a real big difference. There was this introduction to CD quality games, which meant that, well, at the time, it all turned out that you got very, very grainy full motion video and you got really good audio soundtracks. So my endearing memories of it all from back in that time were just that it should have been this really big splash. And it did certainly made it in my life, but there just wasn't enough games out at the time. There wasn't enough coverage in most of the games. Oh, there's a lot of chuff in there, and there's not enough good stuff. But even so, I've still got a massive soft spot for it. I still collect Sega Mega CD games to this day, and I think the Sega Mega CD 1 is genuinely a beautiful console, admittedly, for the 90s. So, the Drisk, please tell us about your memories of the Sega Mega CD. I, for one, am really interested to know your backstory with it.
Yeah, I mean, for me, with the Mega CD, I looked on with envy at the time. I had a friend that bought the Mega CD. I was still an Amiga boy back in, back when this came out. But I remember reading in all the magazines avidly, because they really made a big splash. And of course, we didn't see it until 1993. So in Japan, it came out in 1991, admittedly the tail end of 1991. So and then the US got it the following year in 92. So there was all that time where we were just looking on in wonder. And I remember a good friend of mine back in the day, he was a huge Sega nut. He everybody has that one friend that that the parents seem to have unlimited money and would buy whatever system that he wanted.
I mean, I'm from Stoke-on-Trent, so that didn't really happen, to be honest with you. We were all, still playing with balls and cups and stuff.
Well, he was very much like that. And I remember before we got it over here in Europe, telling me these exciting stories that, it was going to come out with arcade perfect games, things like Outrun and Super Hang-On. It was going to be arcade perfect, indistinguishable, and even better because it was going to have like the music. And these are sort of things that magazines back in the day were saying. So our excitement was palpable. And then I always remember him calling me round because he's got it just arrived, and the first game he had was Wonder Dog, which for those who don't remember, was a core platformer. It's cute, but nothing special. We're both looking at it and thinking, this is no different from the Amiga, really.
Oh, of course, not the Amiga. I've never had an Amiga. So that must have been... Did you dare to say you were disappointed about that? made, obviously spent a lot of money on a Mega CD and whatnot. They were very expensive at the time.
They were. No, I was trying to console him. He was the one that was really depressed. But to be honest, though, and this is the thing people always say about the Mega CD. They say, you know, it's just full of rubbish games. And it's true, there are a lot of terrible games. But in between all those terrible games are some real classics that only come out on the machine. There are some really, really good gems, and you know, often the best versions, you know, some of the ones we're going to be discussing, it's going to, you know, they were the best versions on the Mega CD format.
Absolutely, some of these games are ones that you can still pick up now, play them today, and they're excellent. Well, there's one actually that probably isn't, but you know, that'll be a surprise at the end, I believe. But there might be a bit of a clue in there. Don't listen to this at night.
I think you're giving it away there, aren't
you? Maybe a little bit. But here's the thing, this Mega CD, like, when I remember getting it and showing it to my friends, and they were blown away by the music. That was a big thing that, like, I remember being different, because just to give a little bit of history that segues out a tiny bit, I had a Mega Drive and then a Super Famicom, a Japanese Super Nintendo, and I can remember thinking that the music on the Super Famicom, and I still do, is absolutely incredible. Still love the stuff. So I was always very keen on the audio side of things. I never had an Amiga, but of course I greatly admired the sound that they made and the music that they made, because it was second to none.
Yeah.
Amazing. But here, so when we put on the actual games and they had real audio soundtracks with real instruments and people singing, you know, with the very typical J-pop, J-rock kind of things that came out at the time.
Yeah.
That was the first thing that blew your socks off. But admittedly, a lot of the gaming experience was thin on the ground, because for those who were to purchase a European Mega CD at the time, they would have got Cobra Command.
Yeah.
Another game that we're going to be talking about later. I may as well say what it is now, because it's so obvious people have got Mega CD. But I call it Sol-Feace, but I don't believe it's not. It's actually Sol-Feace or something like that.
Sol-Feace, yeah. Or I believe Sol-Feace. It's Sol-Feace, yeah. But it's, and it's called Sol. I think in the US, for our US listeners, Sol-Dias, they call it there.
Perhaps they
thought it sounded a bit too like, you know, feces or something. but they changed it for some reason in the US to Sol-Dias.
Yeah, and so you've got the Cobra Command, you've got Sol-Feace, which are both, they're both shooters. One is an FMV that looks like a cartoon, which is an on-rail shooter, which is a decent game. It's certainly not on my... I love the music of that game, and I like the overall vibe of it. Sol-Feace is a game that could have just come out on the Mega Drive, admittedly. I think it actually did come out as a cartridge, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, I believe so, yeah. So,
yeah,
but, you know, it's an enjoyable, we'll come to that later, isn't it, with the game, but it's an enjoyable shooter, isn't it?
It is, and the one thing you would have is it was by Wolf Team, wasn't it? So you had this really cool intro, this all this cool music that, of course, you wouldn't have experienced before. Yeah. But the actual game is very much like a Mega Drive game, and unfortunately, the rest of the games you would get would be the arcade classics, which was five games on one disc, which is very impressive at the time, more than one game on it. But of course, it's Golden Axe, it's Streets of Rage, Columns, Super Monaco GP. There's one more off the top of my head which I can't remember, which is a shame. But it's not. None of them. They're no different, apart from some of them have different sound effects, and I think some of them have different music. So, if you were to show off the system, there was nothing truly that said, "Congratulations, you've got a Mega CD. You've moved into the next generation."
Not right off the bat, anyway.
No, not absolutely. So I think that's like one of the things that helped to contribute to its complete failure in the end. Especially, I mean, it failed in all territories, but it did terrible in Europe, especially.
I mean, I think in Europe it's just simply not. And you think 1993. It's too late in Europe. It just came by that time. People were already waiting for things like, you know, the upcoming PlayStation and things like that. So, you know, it wasn't that far. CD was becoming a old hat almost by the time you got to it, that period, really, when it came out, because it was quite late in 93, I think.
So, yeah, it's a very good point, actually, because don't forget, it's not just about the PlayStation. That's a glimmer in most people's eyes there. It was certainly wasn't a mainstream thing. But what you did have is lots of people were talking about... You had Trip Hawkins being on every single program, every single magazine to get his hands on to talk about the 3DO.
Yeah.
And I was one of these people who went out and got a 3DO. So, you know, another good console to talk about another time. Because
definitely, yeah.
I know me and you both like it. Yeah. And then you had that, and then you had like the PlayStation. Obviously, things take off from there. So the Mega CD, obviously being an add-on and all that, doesn't help its cause. But it was one issue we're kind of skating over is that, you know, there are probably about 20 games that are playable, but like 10 outstanding games of class. And if you had to be honest, most of them, with a very few exceptions, could have been done on the Mega Drive, but they had like better sound. And I think for most people, once we saw this big, huge, clunky, beautiful, in my opinion, peripheral being attached to it, I think we thought we were going to get a lot more than we bargained for. And of course, they banked so much on full motion video and giving us these very American Hollywood experiences, which just didn't work, let's face it.
Yeah.
Because that's not the way games have gone. They've done storytelling of the same fashion that they were trying, but with graphics natively being produced by the system. So I think that's a good way to put like our thoughts and feelings about why we're talking about the Mega CD. It's still, to me, quite a novel console. It's certainly got a novelty factor about it, don't you think?
I love the machine. Out of curiosity, which one do you tend to go for? You went for the Model 1, or have you got the Model 2?
I've never had the Model 2 because I just don't like it, which is, you know, it's very much a personal preference. I don't like the Mega Drive 2, and I don't like the Mega Drive, the Mega CD 2. You know, if you get hold of one, fair enough, but out of choice, it's always been the Model 1 for me. It's the one I had back in the day.
Yeah.
It's the one that's on the desk right now. And I love the lights on it, all that kind of stuff. It's the nostalgia factor.
Yeah.
The Mega CD, it doesn't have that same... I don't know how else to put this, like the je ne sais quoi, I would say.
I mean, the only thing for those thinking of buying a sort of a Mega CD... is the trouble with the Model 1 that goes with the Mega Drive, as beautiful as it is, that there's a common issue where the CD tray, usually the belt, either breaks down or the motor mechanism, which is a bit of a pain. Of course, the nice thing with the CD2, which sits at the side of the Mega Drive 2, it's like a lift up, so there's a lot less to go wrong with it, which is kind of nice. I kind of like both. I'm the same as you. I prefer the one on the Model 1. You seem to get an awful lot for your money. Of course, it was really expensive back in the day to buy one.
It really was. I mean, I remember us getting one, and you know, if I'm not mistaken, and I haven't got this to hand as information, I'm going off memory. It's an exaggeration to say they were like £299 as an add-on.
Yeah, it was something like that. And because I know it was that in dollars, and it usually was like for like, wasn't it? They just up the price. I remember it was a ridiculous amount. I certainly knew I was never going to ever get one. Although the price did drop quite soon after.
Oh, it sure didn't. And I think in context, the Mega Drive at the time, so one of the best-selling consoles of all time, was some of the best games you could get in the home market, unless of course you're an Amiga fan. Of course, the Mega Drive, I'm sure you'd agree, is a fantastic console. That was going for about £149 at the time.
Yeah.
So it was worth double, and you had to have a Mega Drive. So, you know, you're talking anywhere between £400 to £500 to become a Mega CD customer and to get the Mega CD experience. And of course, like I referred to earlier, when you first showed people these games, like, they were pretty much just like, is that it? Like, so it's oh, right, it's the same game, but with a bit of music. Oh, that's good.
I know, it's crazy, isn't it? But, no, as you say, some really classic games, which we're going to talk about coming up, is it? Or
absolutely, of course, yeah. You've segued into it. You've done my job for me. I appreciate it. So the first one up is probably the best game on the system, which, of course, that's me probably being a bit biased. I love this game. I've always loved it on the arcade. It is as close to arcade perfect as you can get in a home console. I can't notice the difference between the arcade and the Mega CD, though I am aware out there, listeners, that there are differences, but I would hasten to add that you probably couldn't notice them unless you were looking for them. Of course, I am talking about the number one arcade hit by Capcom, Final Fight CD, which came out on the Mega CD. And my God, this was the game that we'd all been waiting for. This is what we hoped would be coming to the home market. Drisk, just how incredible is this game in terms of its conversion from the arcade?
It's a wonderful home port. And, and to give people a bit of sort of context, you see, up until this point, you had the SNES Final Fight home port, which although looked very, looked nice, it was missing any co-op play. It was missing Guy, which is one of the characters. There's three characters in the arcade original. You had Mike, Hagar, Cody and Guy. So it was three players, not on the SNES version.
You only got two.
So when this came out in 1993, it's just stunning, isn't it? And as you say, it's a really solid port. There are some differences in terms of minor differences in terms of the palette, the color palette. The Mega Drive can't really keep up to the arcade original, and there's slightly less bad guys on the screen than the arcade, but beyond that it's pretty negligible. It's a solid Amiga port, but they added so much more as well, wasn't it, on this version, because you had the very cheesy new cutscene with it all, with all the voiceovers.
I should do an impression right now because I still it's so terrible. It goes, "You son of a, what have you done with her? Mr. Hager," and all that. It's like the worst voice acting ever, but the actual artwork's fantastic. For the time, of course. It's a very ropey story anyway. It's a typical damsel in distress being stolen away. But the one thing I'd say is that one of the big highlights, which isn't the voice acting, is the music. I think the music in this game is absolutely amazing. The arranged soundtrack that they did for it.
Absolutely stunning, isn't it?
Yeah, there's a few cheesy ones, though, particularly the one where you have to fight all the Andor brothers. All of a sudden, it's a very enigmatic tune that goes all over the place, and all of a sudden you've got somebody just literally warbling, and he actually does have some lyrics. If for those who've listened to that song all the way, he does say "reach out" at some point. He was like, "reach out." I've been waiting for this moment for a while, the Drist, to talk about Final Fight CD. God, I love the game.
It is. I had such a fun playthrough, because I've got it's one of those games I've got on my shelf, and it was a great opportunity to sort of replay, because of course normally I tend to go these days to straight to the arcade version, because of course you can emulate. But I'm glad we did this, because it really reminded me, how good this is, and the music and the cutscenes really give you something more to the game over the arcade, really.
Yeah, I mean, I actually prefer the Mega CD version, but it's the nostalgia, and it's also the fact that the music's so great, and obviously the music isn't as good in the arcade version, because of course it is an arcade board, it is limited to the fact it doesn't have CD quality audio. But here's the thing, when it comes to comparing the Mega CD version to the arcade, obviously the arcade's going to win out in some places.
Yeah.
But what you've got to bear in mind, which you've said, if you wanted to play Final Fight at home, you had to play it on the SNES, where you could only have four players on screen at once, or was it even three? I don't remember. It ruins the whole experience. It makes it not... It does look good, in all fairness, as you said, but... it doesn't play as well, and obviously I haven't got the co-op. Then, of course, you've got the Amiga version, which it makes it look like someone's taken photos of the arcade version and drawn over them, because the palette's not as good and that kind of thing.
Yeah.
It's perfectly playable, but it's nowhere near as good as the SNES version in some ways.
Well, the problem with the Amiga is the of course it's only single button as well.
Yeah, which is always a bit of a pain.
Yeah, it just doesn't work with these sort of games. What sort of player do you which player do you tend to go for when you play Final Fight?
It's always It's always Hagar or Hagar. He's called on the... I mean, this is the thing, isn't it? On the Mega CD version, at the start, they refer to him as Mike Hagar. But to me, it's always been Hagar and always will be.
Yeah, yeah.
Man, because he could do the pile driver and he could do that spinning lariat move where I just liked him. And also, he has a killer mustache.
Well, he's Jesse Ventura, isn't he?
He actually is Jesse Ventura. That is totally who he is.
Yeah.
And Cody Guy, I was never really that into. I didn't like the name Cody or Guy. I thought they had uncool names at the time, believe it or not.
Yeah, I mean, I think most people go for Hagar just because he's just so cool, and you say he can do the pile drivers. I mean, there's a lot of like nods to wrestling in this game, isn't it? Because you've got Andore Jr. that looks strangely like Andre the Giant. And,
oh yeah, he's totally Andre the Giant, isn't he?
No, as I say, I had a total blast playing through this again. It was great. And as I say, we're hoping, isn't it, we're going to try and do a video version of this so we can show you some of the footage, because as terrible as my game playing was, I recorded everything I've played so you can see how bad I am at playing these games.
I think it's a great idea. Fight CD, if you are interested in starting off the Mega CD library and you want to start picking up some of the games for yourself, yeah, Final Fight PD's pretty much got to be the first one. If you've got any inkling that you like this game back in the day, or you like Double Dragon, games like that, and you've not played Final Fight before, you've got to go out and get it, because this was, it's better than all of them, and in the home you're just going to enjoy this so much, and you can enjoy it with a friend.
Definitely.
It is two player. So with that, I think we've given great justice to the amazing game that is Final Fight CD. Now we move on to a very different game, that one that's close to my heart, but perhaps less so yours, Driscoll. I'm really looking forward to getting your side of the story on this one. The next game up that we think is a part of the top five or of games is the Jaguar XJ220. Now, this all comes from the fact that I love the cover art for some reason. And also, I've got a soft spot for Jaguars because of this game. And I thought the XJ220 looked like something out of Buck Rogers or something. Thought it was an absolutely amazing supercar. I guess it still is. Not something that I've researched. And at the time, as a racing game, it was certainly a lot better than something like, I'm trying to think of an equivalent, like Hang On or something like that. There was definitely a difference. It used some of the hardware scaling that the Mega CD could bring to the party that you didn't see in Mega Drive. Now, admittedly, if you played it today, you'd be thinking, why on earth have I recommended it to you? But it's very much picked on it being a nostalgia pick, and the fact that it's so blatantly an advertisement, basically, for Jaguar.
Yeah, I love this game because I come from an Amiga background. This was a huge hit on the Amiga. You know, it first came out on the Amiga. And it was basically it's done by Core Design. They released it in 1992, and it was their answer to the game Turbo Lotus Esprit and the Lotus games.
Yes, I was about to just say they were done by the Titus crew, and what they call Titus Soft.
No, the Lotus games were done by Gremlin. So, and that's where there's quite a backstory with this, because for those who don't know, Core Design used to be part of Gremlin, and they were basically laid off, and out of the ashes they set up a new company called Core Design. So it was also, you know, not only are they trying to do a Lotus beta, but they were also ex Gremlin staff, that although a separate team did the Lotus games, Magnetic Fields, nevertheless they were sort of part of the Gremlin sort of canon, so there was a lot of rivalry between the two. And I think they did an amazing job with, you know, Jaguar XJ220, and more so as well. In many ways, it even surpasses the Lotus games, and the Mega CD. I would go even further because of the extra of, you know, the CD format and the fact that it was on the Mega CD, because I think there was some extra chips that they could use. It's one of the best versions of the game. It certainly runs an awful lot smoother and quicker than the Amiga version. I had a blast with it. I mean, for those who sort of don't know, isn't it, with it, it's typical sort of 2D from behind racing game, But one of the things it added over the others of this ilk is you had loads of tracks. It's really generous. There's about 32 tracks all around the world. But what made it stand out from others was that you actually had active damage. So every time you bumped your car or sort of crashed, when you finished the race, you would have to spend money fixing what you'd broken whilst racing. So that was kind of nice. And the other thing actually I would like, and I've never seen it done since, I can't think of another game that does this, it does the Manufacturer Cup. So as well as you racing as an individual, so you trying to win the world championship as an individual, there's also the Manufacturer Cup. So you have your teammate, who's also obviously a Jaguar car driver, also racing at the same time, and of course then you're sort of trying to do it as a partnership, and that works doubly well when you're playing as two player, because of course you can do split screen, so there's a real sort of camaraderie. It is your teammate, and I think that's just such a nice touch, having that Manufacturer Cup as well brought into it. I mean, what's your memories of it?
Oh god, I mean, I loved it because it is a massive step up from what you could get in the home. So I'm trying to think of games that you could compare it to, and you did it wonderfully by talking about the Lotus games. Those games came out on the SNES as well, and there's another game which I believe from Titus Software. It was something very Top Gear, was it called?
Top Gear was sort Top of like Gear. The SNES like knockoff version, wasn't it? Which is very, you know, very good. But yeah, for those who are on consoles, Top Gear on the SNES, or as you're absolutely right, it did come out on the Mega Drive, the Lotus games. But yeah, it's a great fun game, and it's the music on it is fantastic as well, isn't it? You had Martin Iveson, who did the music to this. He's one of my favourite video game composers, actually. I love pretty much anything you've ever played on core design, he's probably done the music for. So
they do a wonderful job of it. A lot of their music is absolutely fantastic. I didn't know the composer like you did, but I certainly appreciated it at the time. And the feeling of driving on XJ220, the big thing about it is that when you've been playing things like Top Gear on the SNES, like I had, and bear in mind I wasn't a computer guy at the time, I didn't have an Amiga or an Atari ST, it was a massive step up, and you notice things like you would have done from something like on the arcades, like Outrun. There was genuine scaling in the background. You could see objects coming towards you, and rather than just clumsily getting larger as they got towards you, they actually scaled, so there was a bit more of an immersion factor to it. I found it incredibly satisfying to play at the time. I played it again recently when we talked about it, just because of it needed to be played again. And it wouldn't be something I'd play extensively now, but in terms of like showing off what the Mega CD should have been doing, this is one of those games. This is a massive step up from what the Mega Drive could do. There was nothing like this on the Mega Drive. The games that were like it, so for example, Super Hang-On, Super Monaco GP, are absolutely nowhere near as good, in my opinion.
Yeah, no, I have a lot of time for it. And as I say, it's another one that I've got in my Mega CD collection, so it was great to sort of dust it off and give it a go. And I forgot how good it is, because I was a bit apprehensive when you mentioned it as your game, because I'd recently bought the Lotus trilogy for the Amiga CD32, and I was disappointed with that. It felt very floaty, and it hadn't aged particularly well, in my opinion, as a game. Mm-hmm. I mean, I love the music, but playing the Jaguar, the Mega CD, I thought it aged very well. If you love that sort of 2D style racer, you really can't go wrong with it. I had a blast trying to make my way through all the World Championship, and there's a lot of different modes as well. There's even a track editor as well, which is quite nice inclusion.
It is very sophisticated for the time. That's the best way to put it. And it was such a leap ahead, and that's why I've just got to say, like I say, referred to it as a soft spot, but I love Jaguar XJ220. It's one of the first games when I started collecting Mega CD again. I got hold of it. It's not particularly expensive, but it's a game that I enjoyed, and it's a game that who I would enjoy again. So it has got pride of place, even though I've got more, in air quotes here, more rare and more expensive games for the Mega CD. I mentioned this one straight away, as you can attest it. I'm not lying about that part.
And as I say, Mark Price, who did some of the track designs for this, he's still working on the Forza games now. Although bizarrely, he only does audio. He does all the car sounds. He's a part of that team. But yeah, it's just nice that there's still some of these old guys, you know, still making it in, you know, the modern racers. There's some connections to it all, which is wonderful.
It truly is wonderful. With that, with our love for Jaguars put aside for a moment, we move on to perhaps, now I've got some very interesting stories about this, so I'm looking forward to telling you about them. Mm. They say they're interesting, they're just funny anecdotes about why I didn't play it at the time. Now this obviously was a smash hit movie, this game, like what an amazing movie, but he never had a game to do it justice until the Mega CD came out. I'm talking about the Arnold Schwarzenegger hit The Terminator, and it's one of the crowning jewels of the Mega CD library. This is often cited as one of the best games on the whole system, and this is Drisk's shout, and I conclude, and sorry, concur with him, of course. Conclude. Yes, I think it is a magnificent game. Again, music is absolutely incredible on this, and I'm sure Drisk will tell us who it's written by and that kind of stuff. I'm looking forward to that one. But the reason why I didn't buy this at the time, even though it was reviewed exceptionally well, and it looked beautiful, it's got a very good, beautiful look to it, and it takes set pieces from what happened in the movie and replicates it quite well. So there's the bar scene where the Terminator and Reese have the first encounter. That is all done in the game. So it really follows the story, which is good. But the reason why I didn't pick it up at the time is because I had the Terminator on the Game Boy, which was given 92% by CVG, and I thought it was a complete load of turd. And I wasn't going to have my fingers burned again with yet another Terminator game. So I avoided it like the plague, but I have played it recently, and I have missed out, Drisk, haven't I?
You have. It's a real classic. It's a weird... I mean the first thing is, because this originally came out on the Mega Drive, but... when they brought it across to the Mega CD, they didn't do just a straight port. They really touched up everything. They added levels, so you now have 10 levels because people would complain that the Mega Drive was too short. The CD music, as you alluded to, is just amazing. And the cutscenes were a particular big deal because there was a lot of... footage that was cut out of both Terminator and Terminator 2, particularly in the futuristic sections. So they were using footage, I believe, that hadn't even been sort of seen at the time. So that was a huge deal. And of course, it looks horribly grainy when you look at it today, the cutscenes. But I can attest, back in the day, it was just like, wow, this was a whole new host of, you know, we definitely had hit a new era of gaming. But gameplay wise, what do you think of it? So I love the game, obviously, in terms of gameplay wise, but it is quite a weird shooter because it's not like an all out run and gun, but it's kind of like a tactical shooter, and it looks a bit silly in some ways because enemies can only shoot straight.
Mm-hmm.
So you can sort of avoid like a cannon just by ducking, and of course the enemy won't bring the gun down slightly to kill you, is what would happen today. And likewise, you can take out enemies by shooting them in the foot or something, because you're on a slant or have you. So it looks silly in that regard, but it gameplay wise, it's quite nice having that sort of more thoughtful run and gun action, isn't it, or walk and gun, as this is more inclined.
Yeah, I totally like that aspect of it. I think it's a little bit clunky in certain places, like like changing around weapons and throwing grenades and that kind of thing. I'd like that to be a bit more smoother, but I think on the overall, like actually getting around the screen and whatnot, is very good. And because you've got your feet on the ground most of the time, I think that makes it feel a lot more serious, and like, it's not, this isn't like Terminator meets Castlevania. It has elements like that, of course it does. But I mean, like, there's no, like, strange... There's no overuse of platforming. There's no overuse of, like, you've got to run and make a massive jump, that kind of thing. So I like that element. It feels a bit more grainy, a bit more serious. So that's the best way to put it, and mature. And I think that's what Terminator deserves. And I just wish I'd got hold of it back in the day, actually. That's my only regret about that one, because I'm sure it would have blown my socks off at the time.
Yeah, it is. It's a real classic. And of course, the person who originally did the Mega Drive version was Dave Perry, who of course is probably better known as Shiny Games, and you know the team that was behind Earthworm Jim and all of those. At this time, he was working for Virgin Games, but they did a brilliant job. And the person who programmed the Mega CD version was Silas Warner, who hasn't done many games really in his career, but his probably biggest claim to fame is the original Castle Wolfenstein, not the id Software, but the Muse C64 classic that inspired id to do Castle Wolfenstein, which is, you know, there was sort of their pseudo sequel, if you like, the Castle Wolfenstein 3D. So he was a programmer, but probably, I think you're absolutely right, the biggest star of this is the music, and it's done by Tommy Tallarico, who's another just awesome musician. Pretty much most games, most Virgin games or Earthworm Jim or any of the Shiny Software would have his music in it. He's just a fantastic musician, as I think you can testify listening to the music.
It is incredible. I think it's spot on. It adds to the serious vibe, and also trying to be true to the cinematic experience, but also being a good game for the time, of course. That's a big shout, and I think that it's incredibly worthy of its title being one of the best games on the Mega CD, and I would say it is a must buy.
Definitely. I mean, it goes for about £50 now, isn't it? It's quite a pricey game, but it's well worth sort of picking up. I mean, of course, not that I would condone this necessarily, but it does emulate very well. The Mega CD does emulate very well on, like, Fusion emulator. You can sort of go down that path, and also again, not that I would condone it, but the there's no copyright protection on the Mega CD, because the idea of you being able to burn CDs at home was science fiction when this came out, so why bother putting protection? So that's quite handy for collectors, that you can just do a straight burn of an ISO and put it in your Mega CD and away you go. So, but yeah, it's well worth picking up. And I'll be honest, this is one that I don't own the original of, for my shame, and I'm so gutted. You know, when it was me and another friend of mine, we were in this game shop, and it was there. It was just £50. It was there, and you know, when you're sort of two friends, you're trying to be sort of polite with one another. No, you have it. Well, I do. Yeah. Well, I said, I said, oh, you know, Terminator, and, you know, I said, oh no, you have it, and he said, all right then, and that was it. It slipped out of my fingers, but he's a huge fan of this genre and that, so it went to a good home, and I still get the opportunity to play it whenever I go around on the original. But yeah, I adore this game, particularly the music. I still listen to the music on a regular basis with this one.
Yeah, it's actually listenable outside of the game, which that's not a rarity with a lot of the CD music that started to come out. A lot of it was very enjoyable. With this one in particular, it is something to you on its own and just say, what a fantastic piece of music, which I do from time to time myself.
and for those, you know, as I say, gameplay wise, absolutely top class as well. We really suggest, you know, don't be put off if you only played the Mega Drive version, because this is so much better.
It is better. And also, I remembered as you were talking that I actually did have it on the Mega Drive, or I rented it. And I didn't like it on the Mega Drive, to be honest with you. So I think that also bit my fingers, and the Game Boy experience. I wonder if anybody else had that experience. The Game Boy game had such an amazing review, but it was such a bad game. Moving on, though, we should go on to something better, shouldn't we, rather than lamenting game reviews. And that would be, we talked about this pack-in game being excellent, and I believe it was very much overlooked at the time because it's... Well, very much a Mega Drive game put onto the Mega CD, but over here, that's the way you're going to play it. That's Sol-Feace.
Well, I always call it Sol-Feace, but that might be totally wrong. But that's how
I'm just going to say Sol-Feace from this here on out.
Sol-Feace.
No, but they're definitely not Sol-Feace, and it's not. It is not Sol-Feace. It's actually great. It's a really, really, really good game. This is a classic side-scrolling shoot 'em up. It's nice and fast, great action. You've got loads of power-ups, speed-ups, all that kind of good stuff, all mixed together with the extra je ne sais quoi. I've said that twice in the one podcast. That word is going to be banned for the next one. You've got that extra edge with the fact that it's got incredible music. It's very cheesy. It's not exactly listenable outside the game because it's very, very cheesy. But it's also got the added factor of those little cutscenes and voiceovers, which I really liked at the time. So it is, again, a nostalgia pick. But I actually think, on its own merit, playing it as a shooter, if you're into shooters, then this is one that needs to be on your list and you need to get it.
Yeah, it's quite solid, isn't it? I mean, I'll be the first to say it's nothing extraordinary. It's solid, but it's solid and it's playable and it's enjoyable. I mean, and originally it was a sharp, the X68000. It was originally a port from that title, and I think it had a good few years on that. So. You know, from the original, I think it was from 1989 to 1992 or something. So it was a good few years. So in some ways, it shows its age a little, but it's beautiful. You can't really fault it. You know, it's got all the addictive elements that you want. You get your power ups. It's one of those shooters where there's not too much happening on the screen at once, but you also get to learn the placements, and for me that's my favorite kind of shooter, where you can actually learn the placements and the patterns, and you get further each time, and it's quite, you know, quite generous really. It does has six levels. Yeah, I quite like it, but again, I think you're absolutely right when you said about the music. It's a really stirring, upbeat song Motoi Sanaraba, who incidentally does the Dark Souls music today.
Oh god, is that is,
so he's still in the industry.
Yeah, and Drisk smashed it out of the park with his trivia about musicians. I love it. So, and Dark Souls has got a really good soundtrack. It's an incredible game.
Yeah, well, he did all three of those. I mean, he's done lots of games, but you know, that's probably what most people remember today. I mean, that's the thing I love when sort of learning with all the video game history, is seeing the connections and seeing where people have gone, because it's wonderful. One of the pleasures of retro gaming is seeing where a lot of these people started out, and you can see the growth of their career, or the decline in some cases, but hopefully the growth of their career, and you can see how they've improved over time. But
yeah,
very stirring, stirring music. I'm a big fan of this.
Yeah, so I mean, I think one of the reasons why I wanted to include this is because I think it's greatly overlooked, and I think it's a very good game experience from beginning to end. I wouldn't say it's insanely difficult, and it's not a bullet hell shooter. So to some people, that's going to turn you off straight away. Mm. To others, that's the kind of thing that I like. It's not overly insanely difficult. And one of the things to say about this is the fact that it's incredibly cheap, because it was a packing game along with Cobra Command, which is a double dual case, one side is Cobra Command and one side Sol-Feace. For about £5, you pay more than that, you're getting ripped off basically. You're going to have an incredibly decent shooter that needs to be played and appreciated. And the reason again why I've pushed it to the forefront is, of course, it just didn't get enough love at the time. And I think that comes to the fact that, you know, when you've paid around £500 for a Mega Drive and a Mega CD, you did admittedly want more than Sol-Feace. But we get to appreciate it just as a game as it is now.
Yeah, that's a lot of truth, isn't it? Because it really doesn't add much. It doesn't make use of the CD format particularly with this one. It could have easily appeared on the Mega Drive, and that was reflected in a lot of reviews at the time. You know, people were saying, "Yeah, it's all right, but it's not sewing. It's not making use of the hardware." And you totally get that after spending a fortune on a new console peripheral. You at least hope it uses it to some capacity, but of course that could be a double-edged sword, as we'll find out with the next game.
This is my show. This is one of my guilty pleasures, and I've alluded to what it is. The night is coming in. Of course, this game is one of the most controversial at the time. It was one of the first games to ever get a BBFC certificate. So at the time, games would be rated just like movies, and they would have the same symbols on them as well. And this got a 15 certificate because of its insinuating violence and I'm not going to notice he's not quite scantily clad women involved. Of course, I am talking about Night Trap. This is the moral panic. This is the game that was going to turn us all into complete reprobates who would be staring at posters and wishing girls would come alive into our rooms. You know, there's such a moral panic over this game. It's very understated at the time. Night Trap is a game all about you overlooking a group of teenage girls, and I mean of age, just before you even go there. I know some of you are going there already. I mean, these are girls are about 21, basically. They're all getting together at someone's house who's a bit strange. They're all just going to have a good time staying over at this big mansion. But there's some sinister, creepy goings on, and you've got to look over it from your van. And
I don't think you're describing it very well.
And you're part of something called the SEGA Control Attack Team, which obviously the acronym of that is SCAT.
Yeah, not the greatest acronym, really. They should have already thought it through. I mean, that's it. It's weird, isn't it? Because you've got basically, as you say, you've got these weird vampire zombie things that have to use like a device, isn't it, to sort of to suck the blood out of the victims, and you're part of this SCAT team. SCAT team, and you're like these special forces, isn't it? So you're sort of monitoring what's going on by switching to the camera, and I suppose your whole idea is, whilst there's all these sort of like scantily clad women having the slumber party, of which one of them is actually a special undercover operative for yourself and part of the SCAT team, and you basically lay traps for the monsters and try and save the people. That's basically it, isn't it, really?
That is the gameplay. You've got six screens, I believe it is. You've got like six options, like from left to right.
Room.
Yeah, one's a front room, one's a back room, one's the outside, the front door, one's the kitchen. And what you have to do is you have to look out at these different things, watch what's going on, but also these little weird zombies walk through and you have to press a button at the right time and then you will unleash a FMV sequence saying, "Hooray, you've captured him," or "You haven't, unfortunately." And of course, it can't be that easy, can it? You can't make it that easy. So to add an extra barrier to the game for you to complete it, there's also an access code. And there are certain sequences where you have to listen out to the dialogue between characters and they say, "Oh, would you like to change the access code?" And it's different every single time. So you can never see them say it with the mouth. They just like, they kind of turn around to go out the room and go, "Why don't we make it red?"
Yeah.
"Why don't we make it orange?"
So you have to know that, otherwise you can't lay the trap, is it? Oh, it's a terrible game.
No, it's not. It's a wonderful game. It's got so much wrong about it. Let's talk about the terrible soundtrack. It's really, really corny. Well, the acting is poor. You've got a established actor from Different Strokes. I forget her name now.
Dana Plato.
She's dead now, isn't she?
I don't know.
Yeah, I think she is, you know. She was in porn at one point as well. She really had a dive down in it. Yeah, I believe so. I think something like that. Don't quote me on it, because I could be mistaken with another failing actress. There's no particularly good performances in this game at all in terms of actually what happens. There's no real great dialogue apart from it's very quotable, like Resident Evil. It's very poor. There's a very hilarious scene where a girl pulls out a tennis racket and starts to play a song, and she pretends to sing, and the song is called Night Trap, and it's an awful song. It's a very 80s vibe, because this was actually filmed, I believe, in about 86 or 87.
87, yeah. I mean, yeah, do you know the history with this?
I do, because I am a massive, like, fanatic of Night Trap, so yeah. I forget what the actual system was called, but it was by Hasbro, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was a Control Vision, yeah. It was a VHS. a VHS add-on for the ColecoVision, actually.
So it was an add-on as well. That's interesting. So the idea was...
Well, modified version, I should say. Not really an add-on, but using the Coleco hardware.
So what was going to happen, of course, was that they were going to use these VHSs to give us these video experiences. And they were really all in, weren't they? They were pumping loads of money into it. Then they thought, I don't know what happened to make them stop, but all these digital picture... the guys who did these games, they just all went onto the shelf. And then when the Mega CD came out, they all got picked up. So there's like Night Trap, Sewer Shark, there may be a couple more that I can't remember off the top
of
my head.
There were the sort of two main ones. Yeah, I mean basically, this was I-6, which is Nolan Bushnell, who of course co-founded Atari. It was one of the companies that he sort of started up after Atari. And they were basically involved with, you know, this Hasbro and this idea of this VHS console. And you say they did. Tom Zito did all these cheesy films, and it, because done by Digital Pictures, as they were called. And as you say, it just sat. Hasbro saw the results and decided perhaps they wouldn't go into production with it, and it just sat gathering dust. And then, of course, when the Mega CD came along, or the Sega CD, as it was in the US, Sega thought, well, this, why don't we sort of buy these items and get it put on the CD format as opposed to VHS?
And ironically, it would have been better on VHS as well. It would have looked a hell of a lot better.
Yeah, but gameplay-wise... Although, have you ever tried... Because one of the things, in 1995, so a couple of years later, there was a 32X version of this. If you had the Mega CD and the 32X, it would much better sort of... Well, I say much better. Marginally better visuals, certainly less grainy.
Yes, it's a bigger window of FMV. It's also a slightly better colour palette as well, which is really here or there. But I have tried to buy it a fair few times, and I'll never forget one day it turned up on eBay. It's a decent price, and within 10 minutes it went, and I kind of ummed and ahed and thought, oh, is that a good price or not? Because I'd only started looking for it, and it went straight away. So it is a game that I really want. But I don't have a 32X, but that's not going to stop me from buying it.
It's on the 3DO as well.
I was about just to say, the 3DO version is much, much better in terms of its... I mean, the 3DO is much better.
Yeah.
I know you hate the game. For those out there who've not played a game like this, it's basically like a DVD menu. You select, you press up and down, a little box highlights, and you press something, then it changes, then a bit of video plays. It's that bad. That's the response time as well. It's... A DVD menu actually sums it up quite well.
I think it sums up very well. So save yourself money and just sort of put a DVD in.
buy it. It's got a good price in history.
Or Let's Play, which is after playing this game for about 10 minutes, I decided I'd watch a Let's Play a YouTube video, because I just couldn't stomach anymore. There's just no gameplay element. So honestly, you're doing yourself a favour.
Don't make me say it. I can't help it, but confirmation bias is cognitive bias is kicking in. I can't admit it's absolutely terrible. It's an interesting experience, but I think a lot of it is the controversy that went around it. This got column inches after column inches. It was on the news and stuff like that. So it was a must-have. It became a must-have because it's, as you say, it's not a glimmering, shimmering gaming experience. It's something quite different. They were trying to move into a different space. This is the Sega put a lot of effort into making these FMV games. There's a lot of them on the Mega CD, and none of them are any good. Sherlock Holmes is another one that's hilariously bad.
Yeah,
but I've got them all, of course, Volume 1 and Volume 2.
Oh yeah, same here.
Yeah, of course I've got them both. But here's the thing. So you had to take all this controversy back in about 94, and you take the fact that it's actually an FMV game, and it came with two CDs, which at the time was like, oh my God, it's on two CDs. It must be huge. And it's not really. It's not that big of a game. It's an oddity that it needs to be played. It recently, within about 3 years ago, had a Kickstarter that failed. Absolutely.
Strangely.
Yeah. I wondered why it would even get released again. I'd like to see a nice cleaned up version that was of a film quality for the lols, as it were, but it's not something that probably is going to happen. There's just not enough interest in it. As I say, a lot of the controversy around it at the time, but the fact that it was so different and only something you could get at the time on the Mega CD meant it was a must have. It's something in my collection that's sealed or it will never be played. But you know, there's other ways of playing it. I don't want to. I just love it. I love all the things that went around it. If you search on YouTube for anything about Night Trap and like news or controversy, you will see these clips come up, and it's really quite funny. It's not even that violent, Drisk, is it? There's one scene where they're called augers, I believe, the zombie you're talking about. He gets like some kind of clasp and puts it around a neck, and it's like a drill goes into a neck.
That's it, draining the blood. Yeah, I mean, it was totally overhyped. My theory is that the senators were in on it, because this game would have died a death if it had just been released. But because there was all that big sort of senator hearings in the US, and you know, they were trying to ban the game, and they were really flagging this. And as you say, that out of this, they decided to do sort of like the age certification happened after all these senator hearings. But of course, because they were trying to ban the game, it turned a game that would have just died a death into a hugely popular game, because every kid in the land wanted this taboo game that was that sounded like so excited. What are the adults trying to ban? And of course, when you actually got it and played it, it was terrible. and more disappointing. You can deal with terrible, but there wasn't anything tantalizing or particularly exciting within it.
It's not even that rude. There's one girl in a 90 at one point. We said Scamity Clad. That's not even accurate.
No.
Is it?
Not
like,
really.
They've got like, you know, they've got typically 80s clothing, so leggings and leg warmers and all that kind of stuff. And, you know, certainly like some of them are quite pretty and that kind of thing, you could say, subjectively. But like, there's one girl in a 90, which isn't inappropriate. It's not too long or too short cut or anything like that. And the violence it's really hammy. And the scene that I'm talking about where it's quite tense, the fact that she gets caught from behind and this guy just drills a neck.
But
it's not that tense at all, really, is it? You're trying to
embellish it, yeah.
Yeah, I am embellishing it.
I think you need to watch a Let's Play. for those unsure, watch a Let's Play, and then just imagine that you're sort of selecting a DVD menu, and you've got a good sense of the excitement that awaits you.
You've got to buy it. I just think, look, it's a real oddity. It's a piece of time. This is what we thought gaming was going to be back in about 93, 94. This is what all the adverts featured, like Sewer Shark and this kind of stuff, and Night Trap. We thought this was the future of gaming, and it wasn't. It's been proven to be the case that this is not how it went. And that's where the Mega CD dies. It went down the wrong path, too expensive, invested too much into these amazing FMV experiences, as far as I'm concerned. And it's a shame that has to be its legacy, unfortunately, when we talk about the Mega CD. But we need to do a part two of this, don't we, Chris?
Oh,
we need
definitely, to do... yeah. There's so many more classics we want to cover, isn't it?
Yeah, so I hope you'll join us for the next part as well. But on this one, I mean, that's a way to round it up. That's like our top five part one. And these are our enduring memories of the Mega CD. And don't write it off just yet. You know, try it. You'll be pleasantly surprised. But to talk for Driss just for one moment, not if you buy Night Trap, you'll probably want to hunt us down.
Yeah, exactly. Don't go for Night Trap, but play certainly Final Fight CD and Terminator. They're two standout titles that will really, impress you.
So, Driss, have you got any shout-outs you'd like to make on this episode?
Yeah, I want to shout out Tenpence Arcade. They gave a lovely bizarre shout out for my book, where they started talking about the book on Amazon and somehow ended up about dinosaurs unable to use controls, and so therefore they had to use dance mats. And on a real bizarre sort of like tandem, as they often do. I mean, for those who've never listened to the Tenpence Arcade, they tend to concentrate on a single arcade game and give like sort of retro arcade news, and they're such a hilarious duo of Sean and Vic, well worth the listen. I also want to shout out obviously people who know the retro scene. I used to be a host to Retro Asylum, and I want to shout out the guys there as well. I mean, still love the guys. It just all came, it was getting too much for me, doing the level of sort of podcasts that we were sort of like churning out, and I was on most of them, and it was just taking over my life. So I want to say hi to those guys. The other thing that is the other podcast I want to shout out is the, or other two I want to shout out is the Retro Hour, one of my favorites at the moment. And Ravi, who's one of the hosts on the Retro Hour, I was listening today. He did a live Amiga mix where he's got like two Amiga 1200s mega souped up, and he started doing a live mix between them because he used to be a DJ. And awesome stuff that he was doing there. And he's planning to do it every Sunday. So well worth looking out for the live mixes that he did. I mean, this time he did a four-hour set. So it's wonderful. And although he did it live, it's, of course, on their Facebook channel, recorded, fully recorded, so anybody can go back there. And I'm such a fan of the Amiga sort of like music chips and that, so it's just wonderful to hear all these classic tunes that he's sort of mixed in, but both from like cracking intros and demos as well as games. Just a real blast. And the final one I want to shout out is Retro Game Squad. They're coming up to their last show, so next month will be their last show, and I'm gonna really miss those guys because they are such an amazing sort of podcast. For if anybody's not listened to them, it's set in the US, and they're just great guys. You've got Alex, John and Jeff, and they really know their stuff. And really, you know, they're the kind of people that, this is how much effort they put into their podcasts. They will invariably play each game that they cover for several days. You know, that's the sort of level of intensity that they put. So they know each game inside out when they play it. So yeah, sorry, quite a few shout outs there, but I just wanted to say,
oh, it's better than none, isn't it? Because I'm going to give a shout out to the Bury Arcade Club again. Because around the corner from them, and I think what they do is amazing work. And they're open on they open only Friday, Saturday and Sunday, and I think that anybody that's going out the way to preserve gaming and also preserve the arcade gaming experience on a regular basis really, really needs a shout out. So.
It's amazing, isn't it, the Arcade Club? I mean, I went down there the other month with a friend, and it was just amazing. I couldn't believe the amount of games, and it's all the original. There's no like sort of MAME emulation under the hood that they're doing. It's all the original PCB boards, and yeah, absolutely stunning. And you just pay 10 quid on the door, isn't it? And then that's it. All the arcade machines are free. And they've literally got something like about 125, 150 arcade machines there.
And pinball as well.
And pinball.
Which, you know, you don't get much access to pinball anymore, do you? It's not, you don't see it around.
No. Well, there's a place in near where I, because I live in Birmingham, there's a place that's called Tilt, which has quite a few pinball tables in there, which is good. But of course, you have to pay each time you use these. Of course, everything in the arcade club is free. One of the things, the one that I spent in the arcade club, they've got the deluxe Outrun cabinet. Now, for people who know me, Outrun is my favourite game of all time. So the deluxe Outrun cabinet, you couldn't get me off it. I was just in gaming nirvana, just playing it. For those who don't know, the deluxe cabinet was the one that moved. So you're playing the original Outrun game and you're sort of moving with it. And they've also got an Outrun 2 arcade cabinet. And remember, it's all free play. I mean, Outrun 2, you're usually paying like a quid a go. If you go anywhere else in the country, because of course Outrun 2 is still pretty much in every arcade going. So yeah, I had a real blast, and it's so nice because a lot of places you could imagine trying to rip you off, but I was really amazed because when I went there it was really hot, and going up to, they've got like a bar section, and going up there for a drink, I was thinking, oh god, this is where they sting you. And I think it was like 50p or something like that. It was for a can of Coke. It wasn't. Everything was reasonably priced. You know, even if you went for like a beer or something like that, it was all reasonably priced. One wonderful place, isn't it? Really,
it is. It's you said you called it Gaming Nirvana, and I think that is a great place. Mm. That's a great way to put it. It's a great place to leave our podcast tonight. Gaming Nirvana is available at the Berry Arc Club. I will be over there. I do have a meetup group on Meetup, Retro Gaming Enthusiasts Manchester. Oh, I can't remember what I even called it. Retro Manchester, something like that. And regularly I organise trips to Berry Arcade Club. So if you're in or around Manchester, you want to come along, by all means do so. I'll be there, and I probably won't even disturb you. So best of both worlds.
Awesome.
Jessica, I've got to thank you so much for coming along tonight. It's been great to talk about the Mega CD. I look forward to part two.
Yeah, definitely. It's been a great nattering about it all. And at least we got Night Trap out of the way so we can concentrate on some decent games.
Well, don't worry. I'm sure I'll be able to get something
I'm sure you'll have a few ones to test my patience. I'm cheeky, aren't I? All right, mate. Lovely chatting. Cheers then, guys.
Bye-bye, folks.
Legendary Sinclair embossed with ZX, chasing every ghost in jungly steps. Color clash parallax loading from cassettes, blistering Nintendo thumb from NES. Monthly fix of cover tapes bought from the store, Commodore format and Zap 64. Roger frames, budget games and so much more. Flimbo's Quest, Dizzy Egg and Ultima 4. These are the memories of a retro gamer. Life was simpler then. These are the memories of a retro gamer. To relive them again. Game Boy crowd gathers in the school playground. 8-bit wars, top scores and SID chips sound. Sensible micropros and kick-off routes. Alex Kidd's massive fist and silly putty bounds. Mega Drive 2 with a mushroom on top. Gives me Doom 1 with some levels cut. Sony wipes the floor in the next-gen wars. Only till the tides are turned with N64. These are the memories of a retro These are the memories of a retro gamer. To relive them again. Cold Masters bit my brothers, Monty on the run. Games Master, Streets of Rage and Big Top of Fun. Windfish, Tetris and Lemmings on the Ark. Dragon Punch, Fatality and Make a Theme Park. Silicon Rendering and Polygon Lands. FMV, Smash TV and Shifting Sands. Multi-tab Megaphone with Micro Machines. Lilac Wars, Volvo and CDG. These are the memories of a retro gamer. Life was simpler then. Oh, these are the memories of a retro gamer. To relive them again. Toasty.